District fellowship meeting was phenomenal. We did a really good job. I was proud of our church. And when they were doing the jumping song, I'm forgetting the name of it right now, Enemy's Camp Under My Feet, whatever it is, I watched the mission people jump. I was even watching Jim Brunn jump. So I was watching them jump, and I was watching everybody else do. Who's the weird people? Yeah. And I said, that's my church. I'm happy with them. And I also noticed that at the altar call that there was three of our men praying a young fellow through to salvation at a district fellowship meeting. I looked over, and there they were, kneeling down beside the young man, prayed him through, and they said he had all kinds of mean thoughts in his mind when he came to church, and us believers know what's going on when somebody's doing that. Spirits are colliding in their brain, and when I looked over and saw our men kneeling down with him, praying him through, I thought, Lord, thank you for that. That's our church. Amen. I'm very proud. Very, very, very proud. We had a great class yesterday. A good number of you came out. Brother Ushery taught us very well. Chris Combs did a good job. Plus, we had good food yesterday. So very proud of you. We had 36, 37 show up. Most of them were from here, so that means you guys are wanting to learn. So I'm very glad that you came out for that. Brother Ushery has been put on notice. Mark his calendar for next August because he'll be coming back doing it again. Amen. So I don't know how to brag on you guys anymore on what I do, but I'm very proud of you. You guys did awesome jobs this weekend. Looking around the room, you notice the walls are painted. Most of you, I think, like the paint, which is great. I'm cool with it. I go with the crowd. But we have to pick out a carpet style, sample, pattern. I don't know. I'm a little brain dead this morning. So what I've got here in front of me is, and I'll show it to you. Hold it up there, Vanna. Okay. That's going to be our, that's the what they're picking. Anybody have questions, thoughts about it? I think the reason they're recommending it and the reason we're deciding on it is because if you look on the floor, you see all of our oil stains, blacktop stains, dirt stains, whatever. And in something like this, we're not going to see it that much.
Amen.
So anybody absolutely hate it? I don't see anybody saying they absolutely hate it, so... That's what we're doing, Bernardo. Everybody ignore Bernardo, okay? That's what we're going for, okay? So we'll put the order in today, and we'll get that done. So Cricket has an announcement.
I just wanted to remind everyone we're going camping September 12th and the 13th. We're taking the 12 and up age group. The cost is $5. Your permission slip and your money is due to me no later than Thursday because we have to turn in a number. Also, please don't forget on October... The 17th, we're having Bible study / night out on the levee for, again, the 12 and up age group. And then your Winterfest deposit of $50 is due by November 20th. Thanks.
I think that's all the announcements right now.
Yeah. Pastor Appreciation Day is coming up 3 weeks from now, so if you have your envelopes, I need you to turn those in as soon as possible. And I will be bringing a sign-up sheet Thursday for the menu stuff. Tonight is the Make a Joyful Noise service. If you haven't signed up and want to participate, let me know.
All right, let's all stand, please.
You've been in charge of it for the last several times.
Oh, we have a birthday today, from what I understand. Sister Katie.
Sister Katie, that's right.
She's
come on
21.
Up here.
Yeah.
Help us sing happy birthday to Katie.
A happy birthday to you, a happy birthday to you. Every day of the year, may feel Jesus dear. A happy birthday to you, a happy birthday to you. And the best dream you ever had.
Let's invite the good Lord into our service and let's immediately enter into worship. Can we do that? Heavenly Father, again this morning, we thank you for blessing us, for loving us, God, for being good to us. Lord God, we are happy, great God, that we're in your house this morning, God, and we get an opportunity to learn from you, God, and to hear from you today. Father, I pray that you would bless all parts of the remaining of this service, we pray. In Jesus' holy name, amen. Remain standing if you can.
Yeah, you got to suffer me. Sorry. Man, turn around, shake a couple hands as we sing this song this morning. Amen.
As I journey through the land, singing as I go, pointing souls to Calvary, to the crimson flow. Many arrows pierce my soul from without within, but my Lord leads me on, through him I must win. Oh, I want to see him, look upon his face, then sing forever of his saving grace. On the streets of glory, let me lift my voice, cares all past, all the last, never to rejoice. When in service for my Lord, dark may be the night, but I'll cling more close to him, he will give me light. Satan's tales may vex my soul, turn my thoughts aside, but my Lord goes ahead, lead one every time. And though I want to see him, look upon his face, let us sing forever of his saving grace. On the streets of glory, let me lift my voice, here's our past.
I'll sing that chorus again. You sound like you're getting into it.
Oh, I want to see him, look upon his face, let us sing forever of his saving grace. On the streets of glory, let me lift my voice, here's our past, home at last, never to rejoice. When in valleys low I look toward the mountain height, and behold my Savior there leading in the fight, with the tender hand outstretched toward the valley low. Oh, guiding me I can see, and oh, come on now. Oh, I want to see him, look upon his face, and sing forever of his saving grace. On the streets of glory, let me lift my voice, here's our past, for the last ever to rejoice. When before me billows rise from the mighty deep, and then my Lord directs my bark, he does safely keep. And he leads me gently all through this world below. Oh, he's a real friend to me. Oh, I come on, lift it up now. Oh, I want to see him, look upon me.
Oh, yeah.
And sing forever of his saving grace.
Come on.
On the streets of glory, let me
live. Let's do it just one more time now this morning. Give him all you got and lift him up.
Oh, I want to see him, look upon his face, and sing forever of his saving grace. Oh, on the streets of glory, let me lift my voice, here's our past, for the last, here to rejoice. On high, come on, Lord, I love to sing your praises. I'm so glad you're in my life. I'm so glad you came to save us. You came from heaven's word to shoveling, from the earth to the cross, my debt to pay, from the cross to the grave, from the grave to the sky. Lord, I lift your name on high. You came from heaven to earth to show the way, from the earth to the cross, my debt to pay, from the cross to the grave, from the grave to the sky. Lord, I lift your name on high.
Sister May, do you want to stand or come up here and tell? Come on up here so we can they can hear you on the internet.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Last Thursday night and last Wednesday, I was suffering really super bad with a lung infection, which I have had for several years. I couldn't hardly breathe sitting back there, and there was a sister in the church, and she said not to mention her name, prayed for me, and before she got the prayer finished, I took a breath. Last year, I had 3 lung infections that I was hospitalized, but this time, God reached down and heal me through my sister in Christ. And I thank God for that today. And I thank Him for His Holy Spirit that leads us and guides us to pray for people. Sometimes we don't pray for people because we're ashamed. We don't want to be embarrassed. But this lady did. And I thank God for her, and I praise God for this church. And I went home that night and I slept all night long. I hadn't slept in 2 or 3 nights, but I've slept every night since then, and I have breathed every night since then, and I just thank God for it. Thank you. Thank you, sisters.
Thank you. Good morning. Do we all understand that it's important to obey and to be obedient to our God? There's a couple of verses here that I'm going to read with us this morning, and it's in Proverbs, the third chapter, verses 1 through 10. My Bible has little subheadings above certain scripture passages. This says, exhortations to obedience. It says, my son, forget not my law, but let thine heart keep my commandments. For length of days and long life and peace shall they add to thee. Let not mercy and truth forsake thee. Bind them about thy neck. Write them upon the table of thine heart. So shalt thou find favor and good understanding in the sight of God and man. Trust in the Lord with all thine heart, and lean not unto thine own understanding. We have a little bit of problem with that one sometimes, don't we? In all thy ways acknowledge him, and he shall direct thy paths. Be not wise in thine own eyes. See, I would rather be esteemed wise in the eyes of my God and my Lord than in my own. Fear the Lord and depart from evil. It shall be health to thy navel and marrow to thy bones. Honor the Lord with thy substance and with the first fruits of all thine increase. So shall thy barns be filled with plenty, and thy presses shall burst out with new wine. Amen? Amen. It's time for us to take up our offerings. May the ushers come forward, please. Paula, would you pray over the offering this morning, please? Amen.
Praise the Lord. Ain't God good?
Amen.
Did anybody go to bed last night hungry? Did anybody not have a nice roof over them? No. To his riches and glory. Praise the Lord. Did anybody, I'm sure everybody's been watching the news concerning the young man from the Foley family that was over in somewhere in Iraq and the horrible thing that happened to him. Well, my son saw it on his computer. I don't know how much of it is true and how much of it is false. But, you know, I'm guilty of when I see it, I think, oh, my God, that's horrible. And I pray about it, but I really don't consistently. But I'll tell you what, ladies and gentlemen, when it comes in your own home, let me tell you, you're praying about it. And I learned that lesson 2 years ago in a big way. Things that I kind of thought, oh, I don't want to get into that. It depresses me. Well, this is our homeland. This is our United States. That was one of ours. That gentleman was one of ours. And even if he had been somebody that had been born and raised over here, he would have still been a citizen of the United States. Please hold that family up. Go ahead. Life is easy when you're up on the mountain and you've got peace of mind like you've never known. But then things change and oh, you're down in that valley. Have you ever been there? But don't lose faith, for you're never alone. He's still God in the valley when things go wrong. He'll make them right. Oh, the God of the good times. He's still God in the bad times. The God of the day is still God of the night. Talk of faith when we're up on that mountain. Oh, but faith comes so easy when life's at its best. But it's down in them valleys of trials and temptations. That's when our faith is really put to the test. For the God on the mountain is still God in the valley when things go wrong. He'll make them right. Oh, the God of the good times is still God in the bad. God of the day is still God in the night. God on the mountain is still God in the night.
Amen. Children's church, quietly, quietly walk on out. Lori, come on up and sing for us.
How many of you know Jesus Christ as your own personal Savior this morning? Amen. He is Jesus Messiah. He is the Anointed One. Amen.
He became sin. No sin, we might become His righteousness. He humbled Himself, carried the cross. Love so amazing, love so amazing, yeah.
We have got the professor back with us today. He was with us all day long yesterday teaching us, and he's going to come up and preach to us this morning. I really enjoy this fella. He's a wealth of knowledge. I'm buttering him up because I'm just kidding. And his wife is a wealth of knowledge sitting next to him, too. So we are very blessed to have wonderful people like this in our denomination, in our state. Would you give the usheries a big hand clap, please?
God, wow. One of these days I'm going to try to meet that person. I'd like to know what he's really like. I'm not sure. I'm not sure if that's me, but thank you, Pastor. Wow, what a joy it is. Certainly a privilege to be back again here at Mission Church of God in Florence. And we just had an exciting time yesterday. At least I did. I hope others did. And then we had wonderful fellowship. Thank you for the lovely meal and the fellowship that we enjoyed last evening. And it's just good to be back with you today. Oh, and one other thing, it was really good last night to teach Sister Lori something good that hopefully she will not forget. It took a while. Yeah, it did. As a matter of fact, Sister Lori, come here, please. They say practice makes perfect. So you practice the peg game.
Yeah, okay.
Thank you.
I can only leave one now.
Yeah, yeah. Give her a hand. She thinks she's an expert. Maybe she is, because you know what that is, don't you? That's a drip under pressure. So, oh wow! I better move on now, past that. So, bless you, thank you. It's a privilege to be here and to be able to fill this pulpit this morning. I debated about. Because of the sake of time, passing by my wife, but I don't want to do that. So just before she comes to sing, would you stand, please? Open your Bibles to the book of Exodus, chapter 12. The book of Exodus, chapter 12. I hope you have your Bibles. I'm going to be reading a quite lengthy passage, 11 verses. New King James Version translation reads like this. Now the Lord spoke to Moses and Aaron in the land of Egypt, saying, "This month shall be your beginning of months. It shall be the first month of the year to you. Speak to all the congregation of Israel, saying, on the 10th of this month, every man shall take for himself a lamb, according to the house of his father, a lamb for a household. And if the household is too small for the lamb, let him and his neighbor next to his house take it according to the number of the persons, according to each man's need. You shall make your count for the lamb. Your lamb shall be without blemish, a male of the first year. You may take it from the sheep or from the goats. Now you shall keep it until the 14th day of the same month. Then the whole assembly of the congregation of Israel shall kill it at twilight. And they shall take some of the blood and put it on the two doorposts and on the lintel of the houses where they eat it. Then they shall eat the flesh on that night, roasted in fire, with unleavened bread and with bitter herbs, they shall eat it. Do not eat it raw, nor boiled at all with water, but roasted in fire, its head with its legs and its entrails. You shall let none of it remain until morning, and what remains of it until morning you shall burn with fire. And thus you shall eat it with a belt on your waist, your sandals on your feet, and your staff in your hand. So you shall eat it in haste. It is the Lord's Passover. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, thank you for your presence. Anoint the word of God. It is your word, eternal for our hearts and lives. Anoint your servant that I might deliver this message according to the will of God. Anoint my wife as she comes to sing and to minister in song. Touch her, I pray, in Jesus' name. Amen. You may be seated. Worship with my wife.
Wonderful, merciful Savior, precious Redeemer and friend, who would have thought that a lamb could rescue the souls of men? Oh, you rescue the souls of men. Counselor, Comforter, Keeper, Spirit we long to embrace. You offer hope when our hearts have hopelessly lost the way. Oh, we've hopelessly lost the way. You are the one that we praise. You are the one we adore. You give the healing and grace our hearts always hunger for. Oh, our hearts always hunger for. You are the one that we praise. You are the one we adore. You give the healing and grace our hearts always hunger for. Oh, our hearts always hunger for. infinite Father, faithfully loving your own. Here in our weakness you find us, falling before your throne. Oh, we're falling before your throne. You are the one that we praise. You are the one we adore. You give the healing and grace. Our hearts always hunger for. Oh, our hearts always hunger for. You are the one that we praise. You are the one we adore. You give the healing and grace. Our hearts always hunger for. Oh, our hearts always hunger for.
Yes, praise God. He is the one that we adore. Amen. He is the one for whom our hearts hunger and thirst. Praise God. Blessed are they that do hunger and thirst for righteousness, for they shall be filled. Praise God. Wonderful, merciful Savior. Who would have thought that a lamb could rescue the souls of men? Oh, you rescue the souls of men. Counselor, comforter, keeper. His name is Jesus. He is the one that John the Revelator declared to be that lamb that was slain from the foundation of the world. Your sins and my sins and the sins of an entire world were taken care of before mankind was ever created. Before Adam and Eve ever came to life in the Garden of Eden. Before God ever said, let there be light. And there was light. The Lamb had already been slain. God wasn't taken by surprise when Adam and Eve sinned and transgressed in Eden. There was no scurry in heaven. As I've heard some preachers say, they scurried in heaven to find out what they were going to do. No. No scurrying in heaven. The Lamb had already been slain. Can you say praise God for that? So I want to talk to you this morning about feeding on the Lamb. Passage of scripture that we have read together and that we are considering, Exodus chapter 12, describes what I believe is one of the most important events, if not the most important event, in the life and history of the Israelites. Even more important than the period in which Joseph ascended from a Hebrew slave and prisoner to become second in the kingdom. second to Pharaoh, king of Egypt. That was a great time. That was a great season for Israel. But the event that is about to take place, following the verses that I've shared with you this morning, was an eternal event. As a matter of fact, the event of Passover was established because of what took place on this occasion. And Passover has been celebrated by the Jews and Israel from that time till today. Thousands of years have come and gone. And the event of Passover and the event of the instructions that were given to the Israelites by God and by Moses still stand, still exist. You see, this was the night when, according to God, the death angel would pass through the land of Egypt. The firstborn of every Egyptian would die. Sons, animals. The death angel would pass by. And only those Israelites who are inside the houses and the homes that had the blood of this lamb that the Israelites were instructed to choose without spot, without blemish, to set it aside for a particular time, to get ready for slaying it on a particular night. It will be the blood of this sacrificial lamb that becomes the salvation of the Israelites. For they are, according to the word of God and the word of Moses, to take the blood and with hyssop sprinkle the blood on the doorposts and on the lintel of their doors. And they were given the promise of God. When the death angel came by in the land of Egypt and saw the blood on the doorposts of the house of the Israelis, the death angel would pass over. As a matter of fact, that became the inspiration for a song in the Church of God Red Back Hymnal. You have them here sometime. Turn to page 378 and sing for yourself this song. When I see the blood, when I see the blood, when I see the blood, I will pass. I will pass over you. That song was inspired by the 12th chapter of the book of Exodus. By the words of the death angel, who said, as a representative of God, when I see the blood, I will pass over you. Now that instruction that Moses gave to the Israelites of putting the blood on the doorposts and on the lintel that covered the door was very important, because their salvation was involved in it. And if any even of the Israelites came out of their homes, came out from under the covering of the blood on the doorpost of their homes, they too would die. So it's very important that they were obedient to the instruction of Moses and the instruction of God. But that wasn't the only instruction that the Israelites were given in preparation for this night, this Passover night. This night when Jews that had been in in Egypt for 400 years and had been under Egyptian bondage for about 290 years as slaves. For remember that Joseph, when he died, was 110 years old. And the Bible says that there rose up, there came up a Pharaoh, a ruler, following Joseph's death, who knew not the things about Joseph and knew not about his God. So for the next approximately, we don't know exactly how long it took that Pharaoh to establish the bondage, but it wasn't long. So somewhere close to 200 years, they had been slaves in Egypt. But things were about to change. A change was happening. A change was taking place. And on the Passover night, when the lamb was slain and the blood was applied, the Israelites were going home free. They were going to be freed slaves. No longer under bondage. No longer slaves to the Egyptian leaders. God was setting them free. So the instructions that were given to them were very clear and very important. Number one, apply the blood. When I see the blood, I will pass over you. Ladies and gentlemen, I want to make some applications today to the slaying of the lamb and the requirement to eat of this lamb, because we read in verse 8, the instruction was, they shall eat the flesh on that night. In verse 10, you shall let none of it remain. Verse 11, thus you shall eat it with a belt on your waist, your sandals on your feet, and your staff in your hand. An integral part of the deliverance of Israel out of the land of Egypt was eating, feeding upon the lamb. Are you feeding upon the lamb? The Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world. John's Lamb in Revelation, who became our salvation before the world was ever created. Are you feeding upon the lamb? Israel had to feed upon the lamb, and there were some reasons for that. It was because of the strength that eating the lamb gave to them, that they were going to be able to make it through this night of deliverance. Wasn't like, hey, a couple hours and we're out of here. No. As a matter of fact, it became an all-night affair. 1 million plus Jews, 1 million plus Israelites have to make their way through the rest of the desert and into the water and out of the water and into dry and upon dry land and out of Egyptian bondage. It's going to be a night of stress. It's going to be a hardship night. It's going to be a night in which every one of them would need every bit of their strength to make it out. So God said, eat of the lamb. It will give you strength for the journey. Jesus Christ, God's Son, was our sacrificial lamb. Yeah. lamb slain. Oh, who would have thought, the songwriter said, that it would be a lamb that would become our salvation. Jesus is the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world. That's what John said when Jesus came to him at the River Jordan to be baptized. And John said, I didn't even know who he was until the Holy Spirit came. And the one who sent me to baptize said, the one upon whom you see the Spirit descend, this is he. And John said, when I baptized him, the Spirit came down in the form of a dove, and heaven opened, and I heard this voice that said, this is my beloved Son, in whom I am well pleased. We as Christians need to be feeding daily on the Lamb. We need the strength of God that comes from that personal relationship with Jesus. Sister Lori talked about it. We discussed it in Sunday school this morning. The primary factor in salvation, the primary factor in getting into heaven, Jesus is the requirement. Jesus is the door. Jesus is the way. Jesus is the truth. Jesus is the life. Ladies and gentlemen, boys and girls, we must know Jesus Christ as our personal Savior. Amen. And not only must we know Him as our personal Savior, but we must be feeding upon Him. Did not the psalmist say in 34 and 8, oh, taste and see that the Lord is good. He's good. If you're not feasting upon Him, you need to taste and see. Oh, you need to come to Jesus. Because He beckons you. He says, come to me, all of you that are laboring and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. So it was important for them to eat of that lamb that was slain for the strength that they would need to get out of Egypt that night. They were also to feed upon the lamb and to eat of that lamb for spiritual understanding. You say, how was that, Pastor? There are many lessons to be learned in this passage of Scripture. And I hope I can help you to see some things here that were instructions for Israel. First of all, the lamb that was the sacrificial Passover lamb was to be roasted in fire. God was very specific when He said, they shall eat the flesh on that night roasted in fire. Do not eat it raw nor boil it at all with water, but roasted in fire. Fire, roasted in fire. He said it not once, but twice, roasted in fire. What's that all about, preacher? Because I believe that fire in relationship to the Passover, and we think of fire so often in relationship to the Holy Spirit, but I believe there's a secondary meaning here, because I think the fire represented the judgment of God on this night. The judgment of God upon the Egyptians. God is a God of consuming fire. And this night He's going to consume the firstborn of every Egyptian house. He's going to bring about His final judgment upon the land of Egypt until Pharaoh is going to finally say, you can go. You can leave. So God said, don't boil it. Roast it in fire. I want the fire to be significant. I want you to understand that tonight, this night, the night of the Passover, I am not only a God of deliverance, I am a God of judgment. Say, how does that apply to us, preacher? Because as our sacrificial lamb, the Lamb of God who died on the cross to take away our sins, has borne our judgment with him. When Jesus cried out on the cross, my God, why have you forsaken me? He was bearing the very judgment of all of the sins of the world in his body. Can you understand? He knew no sin. He felt no condemnation. He had no personal knowledge. The man, Jesus Christ, the son of David, the son of Joseph, the son of Mary. He had no knowledge personally of judgment or condemnation, because the Bible said, he who knew no sin became sin for us. And so the fire of God, the judgment of God, was borne by the Lamb of God on the cross of Calvary 2,000 years ago. And every sin, every evil thought, everything that you and I stand in judgment for in this life, he took it upon himself, and he bore it upon the cross and upon his body, that you and I might be able to walk out of the bondage of Egypt into the freedom of the promised land. Can somebody say amen? Isaiah said it like this. We believed that when he was punished, we believed. And he's speaking as a Jew. Isaiah said, we believed that God was punishing him. We believed that God was doing to him what was happening for some other reason. But Isaiah said, our eyes were open, and we came to realize that it wasn't God's doing, it was our doing. And he was wounded for our transgressions, and he was bruised for our iniquities, and it was the chastisement of our peace that was upon him. And it's by his stripes for us that we are healed. Oh, can somebody say amen? So roast it in fire. The judgment of God is upon Egypt. And the judgment of God is upon every one of us today who do not know Jesus Christ as our personal Savior. And I say it in love, my heart filled with love. Jesus is the only way. He's the only way to God. Brother Jim, you know, I shared yesterday and I reiterate it. We are Trinitarian. We believe in God Father, God Son, Holy God, Holy Spirit. Jesus is the only way. If you want to go to heaven, there's only one door. There's only one gate. And his name is Jesus. And you can't get there without him. You can't get there without knowing him. You can't get there without praying the sinner's prayer. Now I've heard a preacher or two say, there's no place in the Bible called the sinner's prayer. Sorry. I've been around a little too long to convince me of that. Luke says it like this. Two men went up to the temple to pray. One was a Pharisee, the other was a publican. The Pharisee was up front. He was the closest to the altar. Pharisee looked up to God and said, God, I thank you that I'm not as other men are. Facebook, no, pointing backwards. I thank you I'm not like this publican. I fast, pay my tithes, I'm a goodie. The publican would not so much as lift up his head. A lot of times when I wear a lavalier, is that the way you pronounce it? Lavalier mic here? That's why I don't like to wear the lavalier mic, especially when I preach about certain things, because I kind of get with it. And the publican, the Bible said, smote himself on the chest. And he said, God, be merciful to me, a sinner. That is the sinner's prayer, friend. That's what you have to pray if you expect to go to heaven. I've heard folks say, well, we're all going to heaven. We all want to go to heaven. We're just taking different roads. There is no different road. Do your young people do that one way to God through the power of the cross, his banner over me has loved you. Anyhow, that's what our young people used to do in our church at Loudoun Avenue. One way to God, through the power of the cross, his banner over me is love. That's Jesus. That's Jesus. So, eat the lamb roasted in fire. Also, they were to eat unleavened bread. Unleavened bread in verse 8 was very important, because leaven in Scripture signifies sin. And the instruction of Moses and the instruction of God was, on this night, on Passover night, No presence of sin. Get rid of the leaven. No leaven in your bread. I want you to go out of here pure. I want you to go out of here holy. I want you to go out of here without rebuke and reproof. I want you to go out as your forefathers came in. I want you to go out as a holy people unto me. And God said you are to bake your bread unleavened. No leaven, no possibility of sin. Oh God, help us to understand the significance here, folks. We've got to get rid of the sin that's in our lives. We cannot feast on the lamb. We cannot have a relationship. We cannot walk with him and talk with him and fellowship with him and love him and serve him and walk in the Spirit of God if there is sin dwelling in our hearts and in our lives. We can't do it. The Bible says that when we come to know Jesus as our personal Savior, when we walk in the Spirit, we no longer follow the works of the flesh. We no longer continue to sin. I know the Bible says that if we sin, and that is a possibility, and we do sometimes, but God made provision for it. I shared the verses in Sunday school this morning. As a matter of fact, 1 John. And one of John's, his first little epistle. He said, I write unto you, brothers and sisters, that you sin not. There's the will of God. There's how God wants us to live. That you sin not. Put sin behind you. Leave sin alone. Put temptation behind. Flee from it. Run from it. Get out of the way of it. Sin not, John said. But if you do sin, then I will give you the pattern. I give you the answer. If you sin, he said, you have an advocate with the Father, Christ Jesus, the righteous one, the Lamb of God that was slain. You see, it's all through the Lamb, folks. It's all through eating. It's all through feasting. It's all through feeding on the Lamb of God. And he said, if we confess our sins to him, that he is faithful and just to forgive us and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. We've got to get rid of sin out of our lives. And you ought to be doing that. And I ought to be doing that on a regular basis, daily basis. There are not too many days that go by, and I'm not here to pat myself on the back. Just to maybe try to share with you and help you. There's not too many days that go by that I don't pray this prayer that David prayed. Search me, O God, and know my heart. Try me and know my thoughts. See if there's any wicked way in me, and lead me into life everlasting. You have to pray it. You have to ask for forgiveness. You've got to keep sin out of your life. And if sin is in your life, you've got to get rid of it. You've got to confess your sins. Oh, we talked about it yesterday. Nehemiah. Nehemiah, the layperson, the cupbearer to King Artaxerxes. He said, God, forgive my father. Forgive our people. Forgive me. We've sinned against you. David, you know, committed that heinous sin of transgressing with Bathsheba and laying with her and then having Uriah, her husband, killed and murdered. And he went for nearly a year sitting upon his throne with a hardened heart until one day God sent the prophet and he told a little story to David and it got David's righteous indignation stirred up. And he said, let that guy that did such a thing like that, killed that little lamb, well, he ought to be killed himself. And Nathan the prophet looked at David and said, King David, you are the man. You're the one. And from that moment, I believe on, David was humbled. It brought David to his knees. It brought David to his senses. And that's why we have these prayers. That's why David began to pray, search me and know my heart. Because he knew that what happened in the palace could happen again if he allowed it to happen. So he had to continue to pray, search me, know my heart, forgive me, cleanse me, purge me with hyssop, and I shall be clean. Wash me and I shall be whiter than snow. See, it was important. No leaven, no sin. One other thing I'd like to call your attention to. One other thing that Moses said to the Israelites and God gave the instructions. Verse 8 again. And they shall eat the flesh on that night, roasted in fire, with unleavened bread, and with bitter herbs shall they eat it. You know what that's all about? You understand what the bitter herbs was about? The bitter herbs were significant because God wanted Israel. God wanted his people to be reminded of the bitterness that for the last 200 years they had gone through. He didn't want them to forget that when you're under the bondage of another nation, it's bitter. That when you're a slave in a foreign land, it's bitter. Isn't that what the Bible says? It says the Egyptians put on them bitter hardship. It was bitter for Israel the last 200 years of their slave ship and of their bondage. And God said, I want you to remember the bitterness. I'm getting ready to take you out, but I don't want you to forget what happens when you get away from me. What happens when you forget me? What happens when you stop serving me? It becomes bitter and you go into slavery, and slavery is bitter. Now, how does that affect us today? What Jesus Christ did for us 2,000 years ago outside the city of Jerusalem on Calvary's brow, ladies and gentlemen, was bitter. 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 What else can I say? He looked into the face of heaven and he was so burdened. It was so bitter. It was so hard. He was under such bondage to the sin of this world that he felt like God had forsaken him. You think that wasn't bitter? It was bitter. And we don't need to forget that. We need to remember that. Your salvation, my salvation, came with much bitterness. Wounded for our transgressions, bruised for our iniquities. Chastisement. The chastisement, like a whip on our back, tearing away the flesh. The chastisement of our peace was upon him. Amen. Every lash he took for you. Amen. And he took for me. So as we feed on the Lamb, as we count our blessings, and I hope you do, I hope in your prayer time, in your prayer life, and I've got to close. I hope in your time with him, in your 911 place with God. I shared that yesterday. How many know God has a 911 number? Psalm 91:1. He that dwelleth in the secret place of the Most High shall abide under the shadow of the Almighty. I hope in your 911 time and place with him, you don't ever forget to thank him. You don't ever forget to be grateful for what he's done for you. He bore your sin. He carried your sorrows. It's all because of him that you and I enjoy this and what's happening here at Mission Church of God. It's all because of him. It's not about you. It's not about me. It's about him. Amen. So don't ever forget that. That bitterness brought the joy of salvation for you and me. Sorrow. Sorrow of sin. Sorrow of this life. Sorrow of situations. Sorrow endures for the night. But joy comes in the morning. In him it's joy unspeakable and full of glory. Do you have that joy? Do you know Jesus? Do you understand? Oh, I know I've not done this justice, but if I can challenge you, encourage you, feed on the Lamb. Feed on him. Every day, feed on the Lamb who is Jesus. Love him. Serve him. Live for him. Nothing else really matters if you're not feeding on the Lamb. It's your strength. It's your help. It's your understanding. It's your inspiration. It's all in Jesus. Amen. Can I get a witness to that? And if you don't know him today, young person, if you don't know Jesus, oh, please. I could spend another hour. I know I spent one, so I can't afford. I could spend another hour telling you and helping you to understand what joy in life as a young person and as a teenager is. I've known him since I was knee-high to a frog. Oh, longer than that. I was knee-high to a grasshopper. We have grasshoppers in Kansas. I'm from Kansas. Cool kitty from Kansas City. But I've been with him and he's been with me. And we've been on this journey for many years. Wow. I received my first preacher's license in the Assembly of God when I was about 16, 17 years old. Been going ever since. Wouldn't change it one bit. Every day with Jesus is sweeter than the day before. Amen. If you don't know him, you need to know him. Why don't you come to Jesus? Why don't you start a journey with Jesus by confessing your sins? That you'll look back and say, why didn't I do it sooner? Stand with me if you would, please. Oh, how I love Jesus. Because he first loved me. But I tell you, it came with a price. And we need to be feeding on him every day of our lives. So let me challenge you today. First of all, Christian, if you're not feeding on Jesus, if you don't think of Jesus 24/7, 365, if you don't think about Jesus every day, I'll tell you, God forgive me if this is not the truth, but I don't think there's a day that goes by that I don't think about Jesus. Why? Because he's the Lamb. He's the Lamb of God. Who would have thought that a lamb would take our sins? But Jesus did. He was the Lamb. So are you feeding on him? Begin to feed on him every day. Every day. And if you don't know Jesus, young person, mom or dad, whoever you might be, if there's one person here today who doesn't know Jesus, I want to help you. We want to help you. I want you to come down here and we want to pray the sinner's prayer with you. And we want to help you to know how you can know Jesus and how your life can change right now, this very day. Bow your heads, folks. Right now. Pray right now in the name of Jesus. I'm gonna count to three, and when I say three, I'd like somebody, if you're not a Christian, a young person, a mom or a dad, a grandpa, grandma, brother or sister, whoever you might be, somebody, if you don't know Jesus, I want you to get out of your seat and come here and let us pray with you so we can help you to know Jesus, so you can begin to feed on Jesus. Feed on the Lamb of God, who takes away the sin of the world. One, get ready to come, get ready to come. Two, get ready to come. If you don't know Jesus, the Spirit and the bride say, come. The Holy Spirit says, come. Jesus says, come. Will you come? Three, if you don't know Jesus, come. If you don't know Jesus, come. If you don't know Jesus, come. There's anybody here today that doesn't know Jesus, I want you to get out of your seat and come. I want you to come. I want to pray with you today. Come on. Come on. Know Jesus. Know Jesus. You might say, preacher, I'm not ready. Why in the world would you not be ready to have the greatest experience you've ever had in your life? Come to Jesus. Is there someone? Come to Jesus. If there's somebody here that needs prayer, you want us to pray for you. You want us to pray that God will help you to feed on Him more. Come on. Just come if you want prayer. Just come. What we're here for. We're here to pray with you. We're here to pray with you. Praise God. Praise God. Praise God. That's home, folks. That's home. God. Hallelujah. We're feeding on the Lamb today. We're feeding on the presence of the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world. Can you say praise God? Hallelujah. God bless you. God bless you. God bless you. God bless you.
Praise God. Give Brother Usher a big hand clap, please. It has been a weekend of church, a weekend of learning. And some of you might be saying, Pastor, my head is full right now. That's a good thing. Because if your head is full of the Word of God, full of the knowledge of God, the enemy can't put anything else in there. How many of you know that we as God's children need to fill our brains up with the Word of God? Amen. And then when it's full, then we need to experience the presence of God, to allow the Spirit of God to just take complete control of us. Amen. Are you glad that you know who the Lamb is today, Chris? Amen. Are you glad that you've experienced Him? Are you feeding on Him? How many of you know it's important to feed on the Lamb of God? You have to. Your body needs to be full, completely from head to toe, full of the Lord. It's the only way we're going to survive in these days, saints of God. We've got to be full of the Lord. We have to be. Let me have you stand, please. We have some new folks with us today, and I am so glad you're here. I really am glad you're here. Please come back. Please come back. Please come back. I got a row of ladies here. They keep coming. They're bringing more and more with them. We got to find out where the lady is that brought them. We got to get her back in here. I mean, they're about to take up a full row. Amen. There it is. Give them a hand clap. I'm proud of them. She came to church one day, and I said, I know you. And I kept looking at her and looking at her. I said, we bowled together. She's a pretty decent bowler, and I won't tell you if she beat me or I beat her. That does not need to be known, okay? So she's a pretty decent bowler is all I got to say. Pretty decent. But I know, and I am glad they're here, truly glad they're here. Please keep coming. Please keep coming. Joyful noise tonight. We always have a good time with make a joyful noise. Because we always have people jump up and make a joyful noise who we've never seen make a joyful noise. And they do a very good job because, you know what? They're making that noise for God. Amen. And they do good. So please come back tonight for that. Can we pray together and thank God for this wonderful weekend? And before you leave, make sure you shake Brother and Sister Ushery's hands and hug their necks. Would you do that, please? Heavenly Father, we thank you for this beautiful weekend, God. We thank you for the souls that were saved this weekend, God. Father, we thank you for the learning that we have received from you, God, through your vessel, God, this weekend. Lord God, we thank you for allowing us to be in your presence this whole weekend, God. Father, I pray that you would go with us today, God, and help us to be great lights to this world. And Father, bring us back, God, when it's time. Lord, we give you praise for all things. In Jesus' sweet holy name we pray. Amen. Make sure you shake hands and hug necks. Amen.